Father in heaven, we count it a privilege to come together as brothers and sisters of like faith, counting on your mercies and your compassions that are new every morning. Thank you, Lord, for this time of prayer. Thank you for the privilege of prayer, of being able to communicate with the Father through Jesus because of what Jesus has done on Calvary for each one of us. And so tonight, as we put aside our cares and our worries, Lord, we come before you to find peace, to find fellowship, and to find joy in your presence. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Elder. And the Lord is always amazing. I cannot tell you how many times when I would have my youth elder, Ajua, either in charge of music or ask her to pray during our youth meetings, the Lord would speak through her words exactly what the topic was for that night. And so he did it again with you tonight when you mentioned, I don't know how many of you caught that, because a lot of times we hear words but really don't go very deep into their meaning. But you just said tonight, you have asked that the Lord would be with us and give us peace as we fellowship together. And the topic for tonight is just that. Last week, we studied about rest. And this week, we're studying about peace. That is part six of this Life Adrift. And to start the discussion, I wanted to ask each one of you, what is peace in your own way of understanding it? How do you experience it? How do you define it? And mind you, there's no wrong answer when it comes to this. It's just the way you see it. Hi, Charmel, it's good to see you.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Ted. Hi, Lourdes.
Hi, Ted. Hi, nice to see you.
Likewise, and hi, Lizette. Peace.
Anyone?
Peace is quiet time. Quiet time.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. It's simple. It's very powerful.
I think for me, peace might be maybe knowing for sure that everything is right with me and God, that my relationship with Him might be as it should be.
That's beautiful. Thank you, Glenda. Anyone else?
Peace for me is a state of rest and relaxation. When your mind is at peace, there is no worry. When your body is at peace, you are healthy. You're not wrestling the life storms and battles. So peace for me is rest and relaxation.
I like that. That's why I wanted to discuss rest first, which was last week. And I like the way you describe it, Charmel, peace being, rest being an integral part of peace. That's beautiful. Anyone else?
Peace is an absence of fear, not feeling fear or unrest or, it's just a sense of tranquility and fearlessness.
Okay. I like it. I love it when people define notions or definitions in contrast with something else. That's very cool. The absence of fear, that is great. Yes. Anyone else? You would have to unmute yourself if you want to talk first.
Peace is also not being stressed. When you're not stressed, no stress is peace. Whether it's in the moment, you know, no one can be without stress continuously 7 days a week, you know, but Sabbath is peace for me. I don't have to worry about doing all the same routine, mundane stuff. It's a day of peace.
What about you, Lisette, and what about you, Ted? How do you see this?
I don't know what we're talking about today.
Peace.
Peace?
Yes.
Peace. I like peace when you're by yourself and or you're outside relaxing outside by the pool. Or you're in your room and you're just relaxing in peace and nobody disturbing you.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
I think that's what I call peace.
Nice. So to kind of have your space and not be interrupted or bothered by other distractions or stress.
Exactly.
Beautiful. Good.
Like what yesterday, I was with my Aunt Blanca and she was inside and she had like a floaty to lay down in the pool. Mm-hmm. And I just fell asleep like peacefully. Nobody bothered me. Until I heard somebody laugh outside, I was like, oh man, that disturbed me. I woke up, I was like, but then I have to be careful because there's bees that like to sting me.
Right, right.
Because I was a couple of weeks ago, I was in the pool and I kind of had my legs open like a V. And a bee, I hate when they bother me. And I got it with my finger and it got mad and it stung me. And I was like, he got mad and stung me. I was like, okay, well, I don't like to be stung, so I leave him alone. My aunt, she got mad at me. Why you do that to him? Because I'm swimming, relaxing. I don't bother him. He likes to bother people.
I see.
And my uncle Robert, he likes to save bees.
Good man, Robert. Well, for those who just joined us, Dan and Doris, we're talking about peace tonight. And just went around and asked people to share what they're understanding and how they experience peace, how that is for them. If you'd like to share, that would be great. If not, that's okay also.
Well, peace is not arguing, not fighting. Not getting, not letting, shut up. Don't get under your skin. No, not letting things get under your skin. I have a hard time getting that sometimes, but you want to talk or no? Okay, he agrees.
Well, Dan, how does that sit with you, sir, when it comes to arguing? Is it easy for a lawyer not to argue?
Yes. I'll tell you what. I never learned anything about conflict resolution when I was growing up. So I just...
It's on the job training with this marriage. I'll tell you, God has a sense of humor. He wants to teach you peace, marry somebody like me.
Well, you know that the Bible talks about what is it called? Peace that surpasses understanding or something like that.
Well, we lack understanding here.
No, I don't understand it.
Well, that's amazing. You guys brought a beautiful shower of humor and well-being to this meeting. That's beautiful. Thank you for that. Tonight, I wanted to share with you from God's word what peace is, and hopefully By understanding, just like Dan mentioned, we could grasp and get to experience some of that. If you look at the word peace in Hebrew, shalom, everybody knows the word shalom, and more currently, well, in today's language, shalom is also a form of greeting. But if you look it up, you will find that it doesn't necessarily have to do with the absence of anything, but rather with the presence of all of that which needs to be present, with the sense of completeness. Shalom means completeness, or something that had been finished or made whole, or a state of being complete. And we find this in several Bible passages. We're going to read the very first passage that the word appears in, at least from some translations. But if we look, for example, in Genesis 43, when Joseph asks his brothers, "How is your father doing?" And they responded to him, they said, "Your servant, our father, is well. He is still alive." That word "well" is shalom. And here they were telling a lie, because their father was not shalom. Their father was not complete. There was a huge emptiness into Jacob's heart. And it was there up until he came to Egypt and got to see Joseph in person. Joseph left that emptiness in his heart when Jacob first learned about Joseph's demise. That was also a lie. And ever since then, for a couple decades, Jacob was not okay. He was not shalom. He was not full. So Joseph knows exactly what kind of question to ask. You see, in our language, these kinds of exchanges have been watered down so much. For example, how many times does somebody ask you, "How do you do?" And you say, "I'm all right," or "I'm good," "I'm okay." And down deep inside, what's the reality?
You're miserable.
And I'm sorry, go ahead, Doris.
I did.
I said, when I'm not okay, I'll tell them not okay. It's okay to say you're not okay. I know what you're saying. You know, a lot of people say I'm okay. A good example is, you know, like Father's Day, Sunday, and you know, when I went to work on Monday, one of my therapists, my lead therapist, came and said, "Oh, geez, you know, how was Father's Day?" I said, "You know, it was rough." And she kind of like, "Ooh."
She was shocked.
She was shocked. I could see her reaction. I just looked, I said, "It was rough." I said, "We had a good time," but I said, you know, Shehan had some, you know, his therapist is not kind of, he's getting used to the new changes. So he had some challenging times, and, you know, him around, and, you know, basically he's trying to go from here to there. So I had to kind of hold him, and, you know, that he's trying to scratch and pinch to communicate, you know, because he can't speak. So that was rough time. I, you know, for the day, I showered at like 5:30 in the evening. So, but I, that was the first thing she came to the house, Father's Day. I said, "It was rough," and she kind of surprised. And I told her I'd just been honest, and you know, not to say, oh, it's great, I had a, I'm good, you know. So my thought went to that when you said that.
Yes, and a lot of times I think being from a different culture, we may just have a slightly different perspective. I remember when I was first asked that question and I gave the answer that was the right answer, like you said, people were just shocked. They were a bit phased out. They didn't expect that, because most of the times they call this small talk, right? How do you do? I'm all right. How do you do? I'm fine too. Okay, goodbye, right? They don't want to get deeper into that stuff.
Yeah.
Well, they don't expect you to give your life story.
Sure. Don't ask me how I'm doing then.
Well, you say, how are you? You know, when I say, well, you know, I was in the hospital, I was this and I that. My temperature isn't so good right now.
Nice to see you smiling, Ted.
I think for years we've been told that when people say, how are you, people don't answer honestly. Mm-hmm. It's just an answer that you throw out there to end the discussion. So it's not always true at all.
To be polite.
Yeah.
Right.
And a lot of times that is because we may not be comfortable with that very reality that we are living. And sharing it with somebody else, especially if we think that they may not even understand it, we think it's a waste of time. As a matter of fact, we were going to the beach this Father's Day, and Caleb and Faith were in the back of the car, and they were busy most of the times either reading or doing some art projects. And then Caleb made this poster with Sammy in the background, and here it is. Out of nowhere, he just put these words on the background, well, with the background of the dog, saying, when someone asks you if you're fine and you say you're fine, but you're not really fine because they don't understand.
Wow, that's pretty neat.
Pretty deep.
Yeah,
that's pretty profound.
Well, coming from a 10-year-old, I would concur, but it really struck a chord with me, because what that says is in each one of us, there's a certain chip, a little portion that does not allow for us to be fully complete. There's something missing. And when we say we're fine, we're overgeneralizing, where we are evading deeper discussions. And that's okay. I think that's fine. For most cases, we don't need to give an account of our pain. We don't need to go into details about how challenging our journey may be. But the question still stands. Why are we uncomfortable with the lack of peace, even though that may be a small portion? It may not be like a total, you know, total disruption in our life. From what I hear Jivika say, you were fairly comfortable to say, this is what it is. And at times we may even laugh at, you know, these tragic stories that we may have. We could even relate them with a sense of humor. We could make light of them. But overwhelmingly, and I don't have the statistics, maybe somebody needs to do a research on that, overwhelmingly, most people do not talk about that absence of peace that may be affecting one portion of their life.
See, that's you know, reason for the higher percentage of mental health too today and higher numbers of suicides because they don't talk about it. You know, I'm depressed. You ask me a question, I'm like, I'm great, but I'm like dying inside. So, you know, that conversation, you know, finding somebody talking, and I could see some of my patients too, when I talk to them, they, you know, disclose their challenges. I could see peace in them, you know, like in their, you know, it's like they're unloading something out, or even with a staff member for that matter, with another physician. You know, we're all human, you know, they have their challenges too, but they're treating these people who have extreme life challenges, but you know, then the people who are treating too have certain challenges in life, you know, so they're trying to bottle everything up. And in the end, you know, how can you treat somebody, you know, who needed more help? So I'm saying it's a struggle between peace and honestly answering a question, you know, versus, you know, not to tell all your life story, but I'm saying, you know, I don't know, coming back to honesty, being honest when I look at it.
Being honest, and there's one more piece there, Jivika, is the piece about vulnerability.
Yeah, for sure.
Being vulnerable.
Yeah.
Oftentimes I ask people, for example, in a group at the hospital, I say, what helped you the most in this treatment that you've had? And you know what they say? Meeting people who suffer just like I do. Hearing their stories and knowing that I'm not alone. Knowing that there are other people who feel just the same way I feel. And I could never say that before, because everybody I would talk to, they would say, just get over it. Or they would say, you know, this is nothing. Don't take it seriously.
Sure.
And the reality of the human condition is one in which completeness is not fully complete.
Absolutely.
Let me share with you one Bible verse that will take us through the study tonight. And then we'll read a passage that exemplifies this. This is a passage from the book of John, chapter 16. And this is Jesus talking to his disciples. I like to call this kind of like a goodbye type of or farewell type of meeting. Anywhere from chapter 13 to chapter 17, there are five passages in which Jesus talks to his disciples heart to heart. And Glenda, would you be kind to read this passage for us? You'd have to unmute yourself, Glenda.
Okay, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world.
This is something probably nobody would have expected from Jesus, right? Because we like Jesus to tell us all kinds of good news, right? But every once in a while, he throws a bucket of cold water. He says, you will have trouble. He doesn't sugarcoat it. He doesn't say, you know, there may be, maybe. Some. No. He says, you will have trouble. And he says, I'm telling you these things ahead of time so that you may have peace. Take heart. I have overcome the world. In order to understand this passage a little better, I wanted to go again back to the book of Genesis. Some call him the father of faith. This is the story of Abraham. And check these few verses in which he is visited by God. And the whole dynamic, the whole narrative here. Ted, if you would be so kind to read for us this this passage, I would really appreciate it. A microphone?
I can't see all of it, Pastor, because you have that color thing in the way of
it. Mine is the same.
Oh, there you go, there you go.
There.
Better now?
Perfect.
As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, "Know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure."
I love the scriptures. I bet you if we were professors of literature like Elder Lourdes is, we would go into all of these details. But the narration here is so beautiful. And it places the entire action in such a plastic, artistic manner. It says that as the sun was setting, Abraham fell into a deep sleep and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. I want us to stop there for just a moment. And you don't have to share with the group, but I want for just 10, 12 seconds, I want each one of us to think of a time in our life when we dealt with a thick and dreadful darkness. That is the absence of peace. That hole in our heart that causes all the life to bleed out. That is the absence of peace. One of our kids, and it doesn't matter which one, that's why I'm not giving the name, but one of our kids was born with a heart issue. And when we first learned about this, there was a heart murmur. And when we first learned about this, you could only imagine what goes through the mind of a parent. You see, a heart doesn't need much more than just a little hole, a little deformity there to cause an entire organism to collapse. So many times, that which may not seem too big of a deal to other people, to us is everything. I remember one of my colleagues who has a child with a very significant medical condition that affects her immunity. And she posted something that really touched my heart online. She said to people who say only those with pre-existing conditions and chronic conditions and with existing illnesses will be affected, She said, your only is my everything. A lot of times, what for other people could be something disposable, for us is everything. The Lord came to Abraham and told him the history of the next 4 centuries. And it wasn't a nice history. It was a dreadful history. But the Lord also guaranteed Abraham wholeness. He guaranteed him peace. And he guaranteed a solution to all of that which was going to come. Think about your children in the context of this vision. It would be a dreadful thing to comprehend. And my good friends, if we have not already realized that this world is a dreadful place of darkness, then we have missed the whole point. I don't feel sorry for people who experience pain. I feel sorry for people who do not experience pain. My mother, due to a congenital condition from birth, in the mid-90s started to lose feeling in her legs. And I remember I was an adolescent at that time. And oftentimes my mom would injure her feet and not even know that she was bleeding. And I would see traces of blood and I would be like, what's that? And there she was with a gash on her foot because she wouldn't feel anything. That was first the left foot and then the right one, and now she's in a wheelchair, unable to feel or to move her legs. People who do not feel pain are in a much worse condition than those who actually feel pain and suffer. And the Lord said to Abraham, I'm here to tell you the future. I'll tell you everything that you need to know. Just like Jesus said to his disciples, I am telling you this ahead of time. Yes, you will have trouble. You will have trouble in the world, but take heart. I have overcome the world. This is not an impossible maze. It could be done. Last week in the Bible study, I brought this box. This is one of those boxes that doesn't have a lid, or at least you don't know how to open the lid, because there's a trick to this box, and you have to position it in a certain sequence in order to open the lid. I used to know how to do it, now I don't know, so it would probably take me another half hour to try to figure out how to open this box. Life is just like one of these boxes. It appears to be impossible at times, and it cannot be opened. But the Lord said, I have opened that box. I know how to deal with this. Take heart. And in the same discussion he had with his disciples, chapter 14, he said this, peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Peace. Having that sense of completeness. Having, as Jivika said, quiet time. Having, as Glenda said, a right relationship with God, or rest and relaxation, like Charmel said, or that private time that Lizette was talking about, or not arguing, or having someone get under your skin, like Doris said. Having peace, not just the way that the world gives it to us, but having peace in a way that only God could give it to us. That is the message that I wanted us to take a moment tonight and take to heart. This is the promise, a solid promise that Jesus had given to us. I'm giving you peace. As a matter of fact, every single time when divinity and humanity interacted, every single time, more like a physician who gives like a pain medication or some anesthesia, like when you go to the dentist, they have to do a root canal. They first, you know, give you a certain, I don't know, first the gas and then an injection and all of that, so you wouldn't have to feel all of that pain. Every single time when divinity and humanity come together, the Lord has to give us that medication, that calming effect. Look at how the angel Gabriel, for example, came to Mary. First thing he said to her was, be not afraid. Look at how when Jesus appeared to his disciples after his resurrection, what he says is, peace unto you. Every single time we deal with a storm in our life, the only one who could give true and meaningful peace is God. He has done it for me. He continues to do it for me. I would be a mess, and frankly, I don't know that I would be alive had it not been for him that gave me and continues to give me peace. And now I would like to invite you to share any prayer requests that you may have. And this is a place to be vulnerable. You could also say that you're okay and you don't need anything, and we'll respect that as well. Anyone who would like to share any prayer requests?
I do.
I need more Please. Wisdom.
All right, Lizette, for more wisdom, thank you so much for being so vulnerable.
You're welcome.
Jivika?
Continue prayers for Shaham.
Absolutely. Thank you.
I'd like to a prayer request for our students and their families at Precious Hearts Academy. These special needs families and students, these are really trying times with no respite. And just my heart goes out to them every day. I think about them and just hope for peace to come into their homes and a solution that will allow us to open our doors to give them some.
Yes, for many of these families, Precious Hearts Academy was the lifeline to help with in many cases, severe conditions that their children are afflicted with. And now because of the limitations that there are in place, many families are overburdened. For those, I just wanted to give a little background for those who may not know the full story, Charmel.
Sure.
Anyone else?
I have two requests. One is that the Lord would give us guidance in making decisions about this move that we're considering. And the second request is for my namesake, Lourdes Velasquez. Her brother, Martin, has been picked up by ICE, the immigration. He's in fear of being deported. And we need to pray about this situation. She's very concerned about this.
Lourdes Velasquez is a lovely newborn baby, spiritually talking. She had been baptized a year and a half ago or so. And she was on fire, continues to be on fire for the Lord. Every time I study with people for baptisms or I counsel with couples for marriage, I typically tell them, and I learned that from the Lord Jesus Christ, who just in these verses said, you'll have trouble. I always tell them within the next 12 to 18 months, you will be under the attack of the devil very, very badly. And every single time that happens, including with my kids who were baptized on August 18, 2018, they were attacked within the next year very, very viciously. And all the other ones, there were 8 of them total. Every single one of them had been attacked. In one case, directly by the demonic presence. So the invisible world is a whole lot more real than the visible world. Anyone else?
Well, Pastor, go ahead.
I just wish that we would remember to pray for this COVID-19 and the reopening of things, that wisdom will be used in making decisions so that it's not so quickly that we're going to have a rebound. I fear for some of the stuff opening so quickly that we're going to end up back in our prisoners in our home again because of the increase in incidences of the virus. So we need to pray that whoever makes those decisions, that God has a hand in that.
Thank you so much, Glenda. That goes right hand in hand with what Sister Lourdes said. That was the first one, guidance in the process of reopening the church. She is one of the people selected to be on the task force to reopen the church. Thank you. Ted?
Well, I think the same prayer that you prayed for me before. I talked to my brother, and he said he's not as sympathetic as I think he probably should be. He kind of says you need to go see a counselor. My counselor is the Lord, and I pray that you will continue to pray for me. It's been a little over a year now since I lost my dear June, but it hasn't gotten a whole lot better yet. Mm-hmm. And I just appreciate your prayers for me. That the Lord will continue to comfort me. And you think it would get better. Sometimes it is, sometimes it's not.
Indeed, indeed. Absolutely. Thank you, Ted. Anyone else?
I pray for my mom to get better.
Okay.
And myself to get better every day. And for Jesus to help us out in whatever we can do.
Yes. Beautiful. Well, let us pray. And I invite you to pray very brief conversational prayers. I will be the last one to conclude with prayer. Let's pray.
Father, we come to you this evening in prayer and thanksgiving. We thank you for the opportunity to get together and to seek out your message and to pray for those items that we have discussed. We ask that you be with each and every one, supply their needs. We ask for guidance and protection, and we give this all to you, and we thank you for listening to our prayers. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings, many blessings that we forget to recognize. You know, as humans, we tend to be a very needy society. We always want, but we walk by the blessings without recognizing. So thank you for the blessings. I just want to pause and say thank you for being awesome God and providing the daily basis for everybody. Please bring peace to all who are having challenges and losses and hurting. Thank you for all your blessings. In your precious name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Lord God, I just thank you so much that we've been able tonight to meditate on the meaning of peace, that is your presence in our lives, that takes away fear, that takes away uncertainty. We thank you that you have offered this peace to us and that we have it available every day at any time. And we pray that it may have its effect in our lives, that it may build our faith and trust in you. And you have heard the prayer requests that have been expressed. And we just pray for each person, each need, that you will supply our needs according to the riches of Jesus Christ in glory. And we thank you for this privilege that we have of considering what it means to have peace in our lives. Thank you for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Dear Lord, thank you for this day that you have given us. I pray for the needy families and friends and relatives, for us to get better in this world. And my mom, that she has given me every wisdom that she has given me. She has helped me in my life. God, please help her to get better. And myself and my daughter, for her, that she is going through a rough time, that she's going to school. This, after her birthday, is going to be a good day for her. And my brother that is going through rough times. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, dear God, thank you so much for being our rock. Thank you for showing us that there is hope and teaching us to have faith in you. Lord, I ask you to touch each of our lives and hold the spoken request and the unspoken request in your hand. And Lord, I ask you to be with Ted and the struggle and the time that he's going, give him the strength, give him the peace. Lord, I ask you to please be with the plans of the country reopening, the churches reopening, schools reopening, and I ask you that you be present so that there can be rebuild, organized rebuild at the same time, in a manner that will healing to this nation, that we go back to how life was. And many children like Shane, who are at Precious Academy, and the families that are struggling with having no time for respite, taking care of their special needs children at home. Please be with them and comfort them and give them hope that they will find rest soon. Thank you so much for Pastor Christian and this ministry at Campus Hill Church. It's amazing to see all the ministries that our church has as it reaches audiences that are even far beyond the boundaries of our community. Please be with the ministries at this church and bring hope to the world who are participating in our online ministries.
Thank you so much for your love and for your blessing and for this family that gets together every week to praise and honor you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven, thank you for the opportunity to come to you and ask you for these things that people have requested, these prayers. Lord, we pray that you will look upon us and give us the peace that you promised that we would have. I pray that you will do that. Give us each peace in our lives. Each of us have different situations and different problems that have been presented to you this evening. We pray that you will grant these things, if it is your will. Give us the peace that you have promised that we could have presented to you. In Jesus' name,
amen. Amen.
Dear Lord, I thank you so much for not only giving us heads up on what is going to happen and the fact that the journey is not going to be easy, but also for guaranteeing that you will grant us your peace, because you have dealt with everything out there. You know every single struggle that each one of us is dealing with. And so we put this list in your hand, knowing you will deal with each request according to your wisdom. On this list, we have Lisette, who's asking for wisdom and wellness for herself and her mother. We intercede for Shehan as he's undergoing these therapy changes and different other challenges in his life, that you would be his peace and also grant relief and peace to Jivika and Charmel as well. There are many other families who are dealing with similar situations. And because of Precious Hearts Academy being closed or limited in terms of services, they may also feel an increase in their burden. So we intercede on their behalf, that you would be present now in their homes more than ever before. And they may acknowledge you as their Lord and Savior. We bring the request that Elder Lourdes brought with regard to the reopening of the church, and also a more personal one of Lourdes Velasquez, whose brother Martin is going through a difficult time now also. We intercede on behalf of the request that Sister Glenda brought with regard to this pandemic that is affecting everyone. And we also intercede on behalf of Ted and the great deal of grief that he's undergoing. Be with him, Lord. Help us be with him as well in this journey. And recognizing that in each other, we see vulnerabilities, we see similar pains, that we would be able to support and embrace each other. I intercede on behalf of Doris and Dan, who have also been tested greatly by grief and separation due to this illness that's affecting the entire world right now. Be with their family and the extended members who have been affected by these losses. And Lord, without you, we would be nothing. We acknowledge that you're the one who makes us whole, who in the middle of a very dark time that we may be experiencing, you are our light. You give us the calm that we need, the composure that we need, and that you are seeing us through this difficult journey we're all embarked in. We love you, Lord. We praise you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Typically, we would conclude here, but I wanted to share with you something dear to me. This is a song, some of you may recognize it by, I believe the Cathedrals were the first ones to sing it. It's called, "Who Can Do Anything?" And the second stanza says, "Who makes us happy, though we've been sad, loves us even though we're bad, who answers prayers and makes us glad? Nobody but my Lord." Got it?
Who's a cattle of a thousand hills, who bleeds for us and always will? Who was it tied, yet lives still? Nobody but my Lord. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord and Master. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord. Who makes us happy though we've been sad? Loves us even though we're bad. Who answers prayers and makes us glad? Nobody but my Lord. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord and Master. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord. Who was it hung upon a tree, suffered shame for you and me? Who was it died to make us free? Nobody but my Lord. In the sky, share it with us by and by. Take us to his home on high. Nobody but my Lord. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord and Master. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord. Who can do anything? Nobody but my Lord and Master. Who can do anything? Nobody but
father and my three brothers.